What we will do the coming hour will be to basically take you through what we have done this year, what we have left for in terms of releases for this year, but also looking ahead into next year, both next year and the following years. I think we have a pretty exciting agenda lined up for you. Yes, there is coming. Basically, we will take you through the plans for the XProtect VMS platform as such. Basically use that as a platform for discussing both what we do in terms of VMS capabilities, but also speak to that in terms of our continued journey to cloud. Following that, we will focus more on your specific areas, the MIP SDK and the integration points. We will speak about both small and bigger things, and we have some really exciting stuff lined up for you in that session. Following that session, we will take one step forward and actually look into the horizon and look at what we have in terms of plans and strategies for taking the API, the MIP API, the Milestone Integration Platform API to the next generation, and basically how we are basically embracing new technologies in order to leverage the VMS platform. There will be a lot of information. There will be a lot of different aspects into the VMS, into the tools that you can work with. Should you have any questions to any of those topics, don't hesitate to chip in with a question, and we try to respond to those questions after the session as we get closer to the end. Anyway, let's start looking at XProtect and the journey to cloud. First of all, what I want to do is to make a recap on the two first releases of 2020, R1 and R2, and also sneak peek into the coming release, R3, that is basically becoming general available October 29th. We will do that in four different perspectives. We work with something we call value spaces. Basically, we have areas where we add value to the platform and the overall all-up value proposition. There we work with media delivery, basically covering how we perform and process and distribute video and audio and metadata in the system. We will cover some enhancements we've done on the operational excellence space, basically how people work, how users work with the system, both operators, remote users, but also admin users. Next stop is security, and that is also a very important sort of building block and cornerstone almost for our proposition. Then we will finish off looking into the way we work with partners and how we actually work with the channel doing business. With that, let's dive into the media delivery space. Here we've done a couple of things, and I only listed the kind of top five or top four, sorry, items that we've done as a part of this year's work. Some of them, as you can see, are scheduled for October, but the other two are earlier in the year here. If we start from the left, we have adaptive streaming, and that is a new way for us to work with multiple streams and basically optimize not only the viewing experience in the client, the smart client, but also optimize the transmission, the network load between the server environment and the client. That is, of course, important in any sort of on-prem installation, but also indeed important when you go cloud deployment and actually have XProtect sitting in the cloud and maybe the viewing clients on-prem and elsewhere. Next space is direct streaming, and again, remote users, they are connected through a media or mobile server. We have both the web client and the mobile client, and they access the video management system through a mobile server. There we actually added an option to connect where we actually stream directly from the VMS into those clients and actually shortcut a transcoding process that we used to have to basically optimize the transmission to the clients. That gives increased performance, lower hardware cost, and basically a very neat deployment in those cases. Milestone is very dedicated on working with hardware, accelerated decoding, GPU resources in order to lean and reduce the hardware cost for any installation. And that goes for the recording server, for motion detection decoding, but also, of course, for the clients. And what we've done as a part of the coming release in October here is that we are taking that step, that usage one step further. And we also, apart from decoding the video, we also render the experience in the smart client. So we actually take greater use of the resources that we have in the GPU layer. Of course, the result is increased performance and the better possibilities to view high resolution cameras like 4K and Ultra HD. Last in this space is the integrated and native support for fisheye cameras and 360 cameras. So here you would have a decode or dewarping capability integrated into the smart client, so you don't need to use any plugins or any sort of additional software. You basically plug in your fisheye camera and the smart client will dewarp that for you as you view view the camera. Next space is operational experience, and as I said, covers both operational and management viewing interfaces. And one thing that we did early in the year was to notify operators about alarms and incidents in the smart client by pushing a pop-up dialog into the workspace, and that is very good if you have the smart client running in the background or if it's minimized, and you basically notify the operator that something needs attention. We also work with that situation awareness on the smart map surface. So now we can augment alarms in the smart map and actually use that as a navigation tool for operators responding to incidents. Metadata is an important and really important space for us, and what we've done in this year is that we basically have had a number of steps on implementing support for metadata, both on the sourcing side, how we work with input side, but also how we make metadata useful and searchable in the XProtect VMS software. So there we have basically an integrated ONVIF based search capability. So basically all ONVIF formatted and ONVIF compliant metadata can be searched as a part of the smart client, and we can present the results as a part of those searches. And an additional extension to that coming out in October now with the R3 release is also that we can work with multiple criteria and categories. So you can either use an AND or an OR combination and basically narrow down your search scope and actually have less hits for a specific search and basically shorten the time that it takes to find the material you are looking for. So that is operational excellence. Next space is security, and those of you who've been working with us and been following us for a couple of years, you know how important security is, and system integrity altogether is important to us. And there we again done a number of very sort of cool initiatives actually. So again, starting from the left here, we have device management, the credential management. So basically the ability to set and manage user accounts in the device and also do network settings in the device without using the device's own tools, basically from the inside of the XProtect VMS to set those settings in the devices. Simplifies installation, simplifies management, and basically strengthen up the way that you can round rob and change passwords on those devices. Another thing that is important and linked to devices is a thing that we bring as a part of R3, the upcoming R3, and that is that some devices do not accept initial configuration with default passwords and default users. And in order to circumvent that, we have a special implementation for ONVIF, Axis, and Bosch devices. So basically, if those devices do not support initial setup on the default passwords, we can handle that from the XProtect software. And again, you don't need to do you don't need to use any sort of device specific or vendor specific software for that. Another piece is that all communication across the service and across the clients can be encrypted as a part of securing the integrity of an XProtect system with the customer. And that implies that a lot of certificates needs to be handled and exchanged in the system. In order to simplify that for our system integrators, we also added a certificate handler that basically helps the integrator to set up the system on behalf of the end customer. And then finally, we've done a further strengthening of our encryption on this communication. So basically lifted the encryption algorithms and the logic that we use for encrypting that communication. And that means that we now are FIPS compliant, so you can actually run XProtect in a FIPS compliant setup. And if you are having a high security installation, if you are in a sensitive environment, this is really good news for you. And the way we do this is that we use Microsoft next generation encryption logic and the APIs for that communication. Finally is the ease of doing business, and here we are doing a couple of changes to the way that we license and sort of control and enforce the licensing of XProtect. And here we have first to the left here that we are easing up and basically allowing more channels per device to be connected into the system. So for ONVIF compliant devices using the ONVIF driver, we can now support all the way up to 512 channels on that one device. So basically, if you have an ONVIF device and an encoder, a body-worn system using ONVIF as an interface into XProtect, you can have 512 channels on that system. And the same goes for our universal driver. And if you have a dedicated driver for your device, we can also make those drivers support all the way up to 512 channels. We also have the driver framework, the driver integration framework, and we will speak more about that later. But for that interface, we can actually support unlimited number of channels per device, meaning that you have all the flexibility that you need doing your integration. On the video processing service, the VPS, we are also simplifying the licensing. So if you are doing a video analytical application, an AI application, and you only return metadata and no modified video to XProtect, you don't need any license for that interface and that connectivity. So that is basically a hope to simplify life for not only yourself, but also for our channel partners. But all that was 2020, and of course we have a lot of exciting stuff lined up for you also in the coming years. And if we look at the next year, we have a couple of things that we are investing in and basically having on our backlog. And again, we work with the same value spaces. So in the terms of media delivery, we have continued focus on metadata, so we will further sort of develop our support for metadata, both as a post processing after the fact tool, but also try to make it more actionable and be a decision support tool, and basically be a part of an incident handling process. We also looking at recording server performance, not necessarily only in terms of number of cameras you connect to the server, but also recovery times and startup times in order to have high performance implementation and a reliable implementation when it comes to your VMS system. Security is, again, a continued area for investment. And here we are looking at an implementation using OAuth2 as an authentication layer. We will start with our internal kernel of VMS and then gradually expand that into other interfaces, our clients, and also on the APIs. And eventually, we will also support single sign-on. And you will hear more about that later on in the presentation with Anders Christiansen. Then when it comes to operational experience, we will continue working with our clients, our free clients, smart client, web client, and mobile client to optimize the user experience across those clients. We will look at the smart map. We will continue adding capabilities to the smart map. We saw alarms being added as a part of this year's initiatives. Going forward, we plan to have IoT devices, zones, and other things coming into the smart map. Exactly when and how that will happen is not laid out, but that is the direction that we are going. We're also looking at device management and basically the ability to update the firmware from the VMS, update the firmware in the devices, meaning, again, that you don't need to work with any other tools than the VMS system, and basically lifecycle and manage those devices all the way up, and basically not only the settings, but also the software in the devices themselves. But that is the VMS platform as such, and those are basically information for you. What's important for this session is what we are doing on the open platform and also how we plan to continue on our journey to cloud. And we have some slides on that as well. And basically, when we speak cloud, we mean a lot of different things, because cloud can be different things and also meeting different customer needs. And if you look at this drawing here, you can see that we have, to the left, we have the pure SaaS constellation, video as a service, where we have our sister company, Arcalis, basically providing VaaS services with our core technology, but in a cloud setting. Then we have introduced, very early this year, we introduced a hybrid solution where we combine Arcalis and XProtect in a hybrid solution, very good and very relevant for organizations and companies that have dispersed installations, smaller dispersed sites, and a headquarter being served by an XProtect system. So there it's very easy to have a deployment through Arcalis with those remote sites and then feeding those cameras into the XProtect system. Very cool, very, very nice actually. And the good thing here is, of course, that the cameras that get connected into the XProtect system basically have the same functions as the native XProtect native XProtect cameras. In June this year, we introduced, and very exciting actually, we introduced XProtect on AWS, basically having XProtect sitting as prepackaged solutions in AWS Marketplace. And here we have two products, XProtect Essential and XProtect Bring Your Own License. Basically a prepackaged solution for companies who enjoy cloud deployment, who might be AWS customers already, and offering them a very easy install and an elastic way of growing with their solutions. So that is, again, what we have done this year. And to the right, you have what we are looking at for the future, basically a multi-platform deployment where you have things scattered around. Basically, you can have things running in the cameras, you can have things running in on-prem, and you can have cloud-based logic as well. And if we take a closer look at what we have in mind here, is that basically you have platforms in the devices. Remember, devices become more and more powerful and more intelligent, and ONVIF, some camera manufacturers have their own proprietary platforms like ACAP with Axis and others. And you also have the open, more open standards like the Open Security and Safety Alliance, offering basically the ability to have Android applications running in those devices. So that is a space where you can work with integrations, you can do video analytics, you can do other things, and you can basically append metadata to the video and send that into the VMS system. You can also, of course, work with more traditional on-prem deployments where you have adjunct servers, adjunct systems that basically takes video from XProtect and process that and either add metadata or add modified video into the system. And then what we're also looking at is enabling some sort of cloud layer where you basically can either run services from your own cloud environment or maybe as a hosted service in a Milestone managed environment. But you will hear more about that and all the details around the plans that we have for this in Anders Christensen's presentation. But before we go there, I would actually like to hand over the presentation to Göste, who will speak about the MIP SDK and what we have in terms of development on the tool side for you. Okay, thank you.
Hello everyone, this is Gözde, the product manager for SDK. I'm very excited to share our major steps within the last year to maximize the value of the SDK. Not only how we can do an integration, also adapting our tech stack with advanced initiatives to continue our success story. Today we will go through together firstly with the driver framework and VPS toolkit, and also we will have a closer look to metadata and configuration API. And lastly, we will be focusing on the extending the reach of the open platform environment. Our first stop is driver framework. Driver framework was introduced as a part of 2019 R3 as an alternative interface between devices and the XProtect recording servers. This gives you an easy way of integrating non-OnWIF compliant devices like IoT devices, body-worn camera systems, etc. We had a constraint as of supporting only one video channel earlier. With the upcoming 2020 R3 release, the driver framework will support unlimited number of video channels per driver. Also, we have a driver framework specific and dedicated session with one of our partners, Orbland Systems. So tune into this to learn from their experience and their tips and tricks with Eric and Edward. Video processing toolkit also was introduced earlier this year as a part of 2020 R1. It allows partners doing media analytics and AI applications to ease integration standard tool sets, while at the same time Milestone will handle camera communication, storing, display and search functions. The VPS toolkit includes a sample video processing service with source code in it that can receive video streams and process through a GStreamer pipeline. The resulting video and or metadata can then be passed back to the XProtect VMS system for storage and further use within XProtect, like overlay on video or used by smart client search function. I also would like to point out that VPS can run on both either Linux or Windows operating systems. And also can be hosted on premises or in cloud as well. On the other side, and the deployment options for VMS, VPS, we see that we can see that the flexibility in this slide. Starting from the left, you can use your own appliance, mainly embedding entire hardware stack with GPU platforms. And Linux operating system and other tools that you like to have top of it. Also, as an alternative, you can choose appliance offering with a Milestone hardware partner to create a bundle of your application. Of course, on the other side of the tunnel, regarding of your go-to-market or your application stack, you can also choose normal software application, cloud service, such as in your own environment or private cloud hosted platforms that you are connecting to the VMS. And lastly, We have also packaged XProtect as a product on AWS Marketplace. You have also the possibility to create add-on products and publish this in AWS Marketplace for easy deployments into the customer's virtual private account, virtual private cloud account. Yeah, I mean, if you want to know more, you can check Jan's session about explore possibilities with Milestone XProtect on AWS later on. In the licensing part for the VPS, in our current licensing model, you need a device license for VPS in normal circumstances. Regardless if you return modified video or metadata or both to XProtect. As of early next year, we have a plan to optimize this so you can develop applications that return metadata only without needing a device license for this. If you return modified video to VMS, you will still need an additional device license in that sense. In VPS specific section, we have also the pleasure to have two of the leading vendors presenting how their solutions can be used for VPS deployment developments at this conference. We have sessions with Passant from Intel and Magnus from NVIDIA to explore the advanced level of introduction of their toolkit and how it can be used to deploy video analytics for optimizing the VMS. And speaking of VPS and the metadata side, Milestone based its metadata handling on on-with definitions. And due to the limited scope, Milestone has defined a set of extensions to on-with specifications. And these extensions are defined in the new metadata search integration spec, as you can see on the slide. And Milestone also has added some properties not defined in the on-with metadata standard. And you can see our metadata property samples like age, gender, height, and color in the slide. If metadata is provided according to these specifications, the data can natively be searched using metadata search function in our current scope. If therefore allow you to save development efforts for, of course, dedicated search plugin at the end of the day. If you need metadata not included in the Milestone specification, you can always work with your own metadata as an extension and also to be able to make this metadata searchable, you need to develop your own search plugin as well. And also I would like to share other enhancements in our habitat and we have also done to the MIP SDK during 2020. The configuration API has been extended with functionalities in two areas specifically. These are license management, where all functions available in the management client is now available for configuration via the configuration API. And on the other side, rule management, where rules can now be configured and maintained via configuration API. To get to know more, I suggest you attend Peter Wergman's session about configuration API and all the related specifications. Also, there are some other practical points I would like to point out in this session. Firstly, the discontinuation XML files. We will stop supporting the systeminfo.xml and siteinfo.xml files starting from 2021. And also, configuration API offers similar capabilities. So you can follow the documentation and also can be found on our official website. And secondly is SSL. As we have seen an increased focus on IT security, XProtect now supports encryption of network traffic. This is something this individual customer's IT department can choose to use. And if a customer's IT environment has chosen to enforce security by encrypting communication, and also your application rely on protocol communication, your application will need to be updated to support SSL. The co-innovation and the open platform part, ever since the first introduction of the Milestone XProtect SDK in 2004, Milestone has been leading the market with its open platform strategy. So it's not a new journey for us, honestly. And providing also choice and flexibility for both partners and also end customers. The partner community is today vital part of the Milestone's OLAP value proposition, where we together with our partners deliver innovative solutions that meets customer needs on a wide range of industries, verticals, and product setups. And you know that the open platform is just not some old APIs. In fact, the open platform is a red thread across all functions in Milestone, including developer tools, partner programs, and joint promotion, and also the sales effort as well. And if you had to, had the opportunity to listen to Kevin Mariar's keynote presentation, you know that Milestone is putting in further focus on this area with a reinforced technology partner organization. And more specifically, to be able to accelerate the co-innovation and also to better serve a growing community of developers and able to unlock the full potential of emerging technologies and remove unnecessary friction to unleash the creativity and innovation in the developer community. We are today proud to announce that Milestone will take MIP SDK to Nuget and GitHub. This will be, of course, a journey for Milestone, and we invite all of you to join us on that journey. The journey has, in fact, already started, where we have packages up 2020 R2 MIP SDK .NET binaries, and this as packages on Nuget. This will, of course, be followed up with publication of corresponding packages for all future releases of XProtect VMS. And also for those of you who are not that familiar with Nuget, it can in short be described as a big and recognized repository of components that you as a developer can use as a part of your development apart from giving easy access and seamless integration with many developer tools like Visual Studio. It helps you revision manage your components, which helps you ensure you work with the right baseline of DLLs for your design. And also in the GitHub side, our MIP samples will be published on GitHub as well in the course of whole co-innovation strategy and the approach that we described in earlier. And if any of you would like to, of course, our MIP SDK, SDK will also remain available for download on our Milestone website. Also, I would like to address the available packages on Nuget. These are the specific packages that we have published on Nuget. I should also clarify that the publication of these packages does not imply the Milestone goes open source. The use of the VDOS packages is subject to the corresponding licensing terms as defined in our present EULA. And lastly, I'm very happy to meet you today. Now Anders will continue to present the longer term plans for the MIP SDK. Thanks, Anders.
Thank you. So now you have heard something on what we're doing this year on the MIP SDK and the API, and I'll try and explain a little bit about what we're trying to do in the coming years on the API side. First, I'd like to say that we have been backwards compatible on the protocol side for 15 years, and I'm very proud of that. On the other side, we have protocols that were defined 15 years ago, so they need an update. So this is our starting work to get to a new set of APIs covering our product. So in order to do this, we want to use the new technologies that are more recent, more current. We want to use standard protocols that are common today and people are known how to use. Even though we have standard protocols today also in our product, we would like to modernize that and use more modern protocols. We want to raise the abstraction layer to make life easier when you integrate, so that you don't need to know all the nitty-gritty details on where servers are located, URLs, port numbers, and things like this. We have some help today, but we can do better. And we like to raise that level to make integration easier when you develop, but also not having any surprises when come out to a customer and they may have deployed and installed the products in a different way that you expected. We also like to make it so that when you develop on-premise systems, on-premise integrations to VMS, that later on this integration is easy to port and get to work through a cloud connection. I'll explain that a little bit more in a few slides. We also have ambition to be easier to work with when you're doing Linux integrations. We have several analytics partners that would like to have an easier set of protocols to work with when they're doing Linux-based analytics. So this is also part of the choices we're doing. And the last thing is we want to be ready for using a different kind of authentication. Jan talked about OAuth 2.0, and we have a couple of steps on this. And it also needs a change in the API in order to utilize that. So we want to make sort of a big leap in at one time, and then from then on, that's sort of going to be the base for the future. The way we see this being done is that we have the current VMS installed on-premise. We have the management server, recording server, event server, and a few other servers. If we imagine those being sort of put into one box and encapsulate that, then you could say you have integrations that work directly on these. That'll continue to work, but we will add another API on top of all these services where you can access it on a modern API. And when you develop integrations moving forward in the yellow box here, then you can do integrations through the new API and you're more abstracted away for how the servers are organized below the MIP API. Moving forward, we'll make a cloud access where it's possible to do two-way communication for the on-premise installations and the cloud. And the purpose of this is to make it so that we have an API available in the cloud where you can access or connect to the cloud and it'll actually be carried on into the on-premise installations that'll still exist for a long time. But in your integration point, it's going to be easier to integrate through the cloud if you are doing things like event integration, configuration services, and other things. It'll be just as effective doing it this way. This will also make it somewhat easier if you can do this, because that the deployment, you only need to install it maybe one place in the cloud or at your own location, and you can access all the customers that have signed up to your application. We see the API structure divided into three categories. The blue one on the left is where you have request responses. So this is something where you have a request, you ask for something, and you get a response. It is, and then that request is sort of a done deal. The yellow one is where you have event subscription. You create a session, you make a subscription of some specific events you would like to receive, and then the session is kept open and the events are sort of coming back when they appear, but you have a fixed session as long as you have the subscription running. This is the most effective way of doing it with the least amount of bandwidth used. And then on the right-hand side, streaming, video streaming, and audio and metadata is important to do in a very effective way. So that needs specific protocols for doing that. So what we have chosen so far is that for request response stuff, we want to do REST protocol, JSON. I guess that's not a big surprise for most people. The yellow, we would like to do WebSockets with JSON content. it's very easy to utilize and it's very performance, very good performance on it. And on the right hand side, you see the WebRTC protocol, which is sort of winning in these years, is used very often for video conferencing systems and is very effective because it has embedded hole punching techniques and other things that makes the protocol effective over long distance. These protocols are the ones we have chosen at the moment. We'll do a beta program, get some feedback, and we might change something, but at least for now, that is the way it looks like. If we see how we map these APIs into what we have today, at the bottom you can see a list of APIs, and you could say that today it basically means that when you access data in the request response area, for example, you need to know which API you use. That's maybe not so difficult, but it means that you might have a number of these SOAP proxies or whatever you're doing here open and running at the same time in order to access the data you need. And in event subscription, it's actually worse because if you subscribe to all these things at the same time, you have many sessions running, it takes up bandwidth even if there are no events going on. So that is going to be much more effective having a single protocol that you can subscribe to in details. On the streaming part, we basically have it on out of the what's called image server today. Some people are also using our OnRef bridge, taking out video in RTSP. We want to standardize that. And even though the WebRTC is also RTSP for the video part, but it has some other collection of protocols in the entire picture. So if we do this, then we're going to lean towards standards all the way through, and it's going to be easier to utilize because there are a lot of tools and samples and support around the world for these protocols. So the way we see it from an integration standpoint is that you start out with a yellow box at the bottom where you can integrate on-premise. And that's going to be the first step. And then later on, when we get the cloud connector and the connection out to the cloud ready, you have another API on the top yellow box that you can connect to, and that will carry on the communication to the individual sites that you are able to see. If you are an integrator, you could imagine that you have installed 10 customer sites. But when you go through the cloud, you can somehow see all the 10 sites. You can select which one to work on, and it connects in, and you can access those 10 sites from your premise. So these APIs are something we really would like some feedback on, and we open up a beta program. If you are interested in participating in this and give feedback to us on these things and try it out, then drop us a mail on developer@milestonesys.com and we will invite you into a closed group on our forum where we can communicate on what's going on and we get some feedback from you guys. So with that, I would like to invite Jan just back.
Yep. So that was what we had installed as a part of the roadmap session. Maybe to recap on some of the more important topics. We heard about cloud and what we are doing when it comes to AWS deployment. If you have specific interest in those sessions, I would recommend you to listen into either how to explore the possibilities on AWS as a partner or also how to develop and actually use AWS as a playing ground for your own deployments. We also listened into the VPS and the metadata space, basically how we work with different sources of metadata. And from our side, from the Milestone side, in addition, I should say, to all the external speakers, we have dedicated sessions on different spaces, searches, metadata, and so forth. So if that is your area of interest, I would definitely recommend you to attend those sessions. Then we have deep dive sessions on the specific use of the API as you know it today. And here we have Peter's session, Peter Wagman's session. And immediately after this session, this roadmap session, Anders will actually showcase some of the cool stuff that we have as a part of the beta setup. So attend that session, a short session, but very, very intense and very, very cool, actually. And then finally, if you want to benefit from NuGet and basically the new access to our SDK, I think you should listen into Hans's presentation. It basically shows how you can work with those nuggets and actually work with them in Visual Studio and actually build your own projects around it. And speaking about the NuGet and the GitHub, I really hope that you think this is a easier way of working with us and engaging with our technology. And with GitHub, I basically have an ask to you to actually contribute, comment, add on, and maybe even publish your own samples and basically enrich the way that we can utilize the SDK and the APIs that we have on XProtect, the XProtect platform. So with that, I think we could take some questions, and I'm not sure if we have any questions. Yes. So we have a question here. I have an integration with XProtect today. Will it continue to be supported once the new generation MIP APIs comes around? And I guess that is an obvious question for you, Anders.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, so the simple answer is yes, because we will continue to have the same APIs that we have today. They'll continue to exist. We're not discontinuing any of the APIs. We're introducing the new API on top of all the old APIs. So the answer is yes.
Thank you, thank you. And there is another question, yes. Will Milestone publish different versions of the video OS packages on NuGet and as newer versions of the XProtect VMS software is released? And Gösta, you might have some good answers to that.
Yes, every new release in the XProtect also will reflect to the NuGet. So we will be publishing a new NuGet packages. Also regarding the bugs and defects, we'll do the hotfix and the new subversion on NuGet as our normal procedure.
Yep, that's good. And then we have a question regarding security. So if a customer wants to run XProtect in a FIPS compliant IT environment, will that actually influence my integration? And maybe Anders, if you would care to.
Yeah, so we need to divide up in how the integration is done. You could have if you have a plugin integration, then our smart client, our eventually will take care of all the FIPS stuff. So that should work without any problem, unless you have encryption coded in your own plugin. But in most cases, you would probably not have that. So plugins should work as that's fine, no change. For component integrations, you would have to get a newer SDK, where we have changed the SDK to be FIPS compliant. So you need to recompile with the newest version of the SDK coming out here later in the month, and then that should be okay. If you're doing protocol integrations, it's really up to what you're doing in your applications. We don't have any assistance there, so it's a matter of whether you understand that you're using correct encryption protocols and a few other things. So that's more, you're more on your own there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. So then we have a question regarding AWS and our offering. So what are the plans to extend the Milestone offering in AWS? And there, as I said earlier, in June, we released the first version of XProtect on AWS. And as we came closer to the release of 2020 R3 of XProtect, we will, of course, also publish that on AWS Marketplace. The R3 release will not necessarily contain that much additional capabilities or different use of the AWS services, but we are looking into extending that packaging and that offering with S3 integration and other supplementary services as we go forward into the next year. So that is probably the easiest answer to that, or the sort of simplest answer, because we're also in the planning of how we want to basically position this versus other initiatives, because there are a lot of things boiling right now, as you hopefully appreciate. Yep. Then we have a question: does XProtect server encryption impact my integration? And I'm not sure who.
I can take that.
Yep, perfect.
Yeah, it depends on your integration type. If you have the plugin integration, it will be no side effects. It basically will not affected by this change. But if the customer, the IT environment run on the SSL communication encryption, your application needs to be support the SSL encryption to be able to provide the better process and the environment when it comes to the integration type.
Next question reads, Anders mentioned that there were a beta planning or beta program coming up around the new generation MIP API. When exactly is that starting, and yeah, how can I, as a partner, get rolled into that?
So right now it looks like it's going to be early next year. We hope to be in February, March, that we're able to send out something. But we will, of course, listen to and see what's going on the forum and what it is. But we also need to get enough material ready that it makes sense to do a beta on it. But we're hoping early next year.
Hmm. Yep. Perfect, perfect. Does Milestone have any plans to adopt Microsoft.NET Core?
Is that Anders mine, I guess?
Could you take that?
Yeah, so actually the step with the MIP API we are saying now is actually the first step, because we need to separate the server development from the client development with a thick layer, so that we can do client development in one pace and server development in another pace. Because there are protocols today that actually are not supported in .NET Core, even if you use .NET Core extensions. So we need the API first, and then after that, we'll probably make a MIP SDK that you could utilize in a .NET Core environment. After that, we don't really have any specific plans. We know that a MIP plugin could not work if we change the smart client to a .NET Core application, but we don't even have plans on that yet. So we are talking about it. We have prototypes, but no specific plans.
Good, thank you. Next question reads, is the new API backwards compatible, meaning it can be installed on older systems as well?
No, the new APIs are is going to be like a new service, but there are also elements of it that are baked into the management server and some of the other services. So it will not be possible to do it as an add-on to the current systems. Right. So no, you would have to have to update the VMS.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Next question reads: do you plan to expose the map and the items configured on the map via the configuration API? And
I can take that as well. So in the configuration API, we have several objects where you can change the GPS, or I guess it's called GIS position. And if you store or change the GIS position, it will actually appear on the map, the smart map. I assume we now talk about smart map here. Then it will appear on the map on the location that you have. So we will follow in the configuration API with the type of items that are possible to put on the map in the smart client.
Yep. Good. Then we have a question regarding the new API. So will the API REST JSON content be available in the beta release? And will we have access to cameras and devices, device data like resolution and other configuration data?
Yes. So in the REST API and the JSON, we expect it to cover everything you see in the configuration API today, which means you have all the settings on, I guess it's about 85 different objects we have today. for details. So it's a very big portion of the management server or the configuration you can access through the REST. So answer is yes.
Perfect. Then we have a question, when can we expect to see Milestone on Azure? And the answer is that we have currently no plans to take XProtect onto Azure in the same way as we've done with AWS. But if you want to, you can always do a manual install and a manual deployment into Azure. It's fully compatible and you basically have the same possibilities as you have with AWS. So there is nothing preventing you from deploying and utilizing Azure as a platform. So it looks like we have no more questions, so I think we should wrap up here and thank you for your attention, and we hope that you will have a continued good conference here with us. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks.